on, let's give it up for Jesus, everybody in the house. Hallelujah. Oh, dear God. Look at somebody say, Jesus is the best thing that has ever happened to me. If you believe it, one more time for Jesus. Father, we love you. Amen. Amen. Well, man, it's so good to be back with you guys. As Pastor said, it's been a little while. And so, man, I see that cup you're drinking. Just stretch your hands toward Pastor. Father, healing right now in Jesus' name. He's probably still in mourning, but I am too because I'm a Steelers fan, so I'm in mourning now too. All I can say is go Falcons. Amen. You know, the Bible says you shouldn't have hate in your heart, but Brady, just go Falcons. That's all I'm going to say. Amen. But if you're here and you're a Patriots fan, then, you know, there's great churches all around. You don't need to be here. No, I'm just kidding. I'm teasing. This is just, we're family. Amen. All right. Well, my beautiful wife is with me. Steph, would you stand? Give her a good God bless you. There she is right there. And we just always love coming to Northwest Arkansas. Always hold a special place in my heart here. A large portion of my ministry was here for quite a while. And it's just always great to come back. Join us tonight, man. We're going to have a little bit of a comedy night tonight over there in Fayetteville. We're going to laugh, but we're going to learn. Amen? You can do both. And so also, thank you for all following us on social media. And a lot of you reach out here and there. We launched a church 5 months ago in Dallas, Texas. And so, you know, we weren't busy enough traveling 50 weeks. Ends a year. We just thought we'd build a church in the middle of all that chaos as well. But it's called The Gathering. We meet on Thursday nights, and that is going phenomenally. How many of you have ever caught a service live online at The Gathering? Okay, several of you have. Amen. Well, if you ever want to, all you got to do is go to thegatheringdfw.com. It's real simple. They slap DFW on everything in Dallas-Fort Worth. So thegatheringdfw.com, and any Thursday night at 7 o'clock, we stream our services live. They also stream on our Facebook pages and so we'd love to have you join us. Will you take the hand of the person next to you right now? We're going to ask the Lord to bless our time together. Father, bless this day. Father, we dedicate it to you. We give it to you. And we thank you for all that you've done. Come on, just pray with me. Don't listen to me. Pray with me. Lift your voice. Father, today, let this be an encounter with you. Lord, let us receive from you. Let us learn. Let us be challenged. Let us be stretched. When it's all said and done, let us know that we have been in your house. We'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt we've been in your presence. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Will you hang with me for a second? Because I feel more spiritual when you play behind me. Amen. How many of you believe that our faith has got to mean more outside the four walls of this church than it does on the inside? And I mean, that just really goes without saying. And we're giving all of you an exciting opportunity to do something today that is very, very close to our hearts. Tonight, I'm actually going to be talking about passion. I'm going to be talking about what were you called to do? Why is the body of Christ here? Almost spoke it today. And then at the last second, man, I saw your thermometer and I was like, that's perfect. I'm going to talk about purpose and this and that. And then the Lord went another way 2 minutes ago. And he does that all the time. The guy, he said today, what's your sermon title? Pastor, I said, I don't know. He's like, okay, I'll put that down. I was like, no, it's not I don't know. That's not the sermon title. I'm just saying I have no idea what the sermon title is. And sure enough, God flips it up on me just 2 minutes ago. But a little over a year ago, we got the phenomenal opportunity to join forces with a phenomenal ministry that was for many, many years called Mission of Mercy. It started in 1954 with Drs. Mark and Huldah Buntain in Calcutta, India. The ministry survives today is a ministry entitled One Child Matters, and it's very, very, very dear to our hearts. They basically minister to children in 15 of the poorest nations in the world. And it's just a phenomenal thing that they do. They basically give children 5 of the most critical things that they need in order to have a successful life. How many of you know we're blessed here in Gentry? Amen. We're blessed in Northwest Arkansas. You say, oh man, I've had it rough too. Friends, come on, you live in the United States of America. Need I say anything else? Because I can tell you right now, I can go to any major city in the U.S. and I can take a bum living under a bridge that's homeless, and he lives like a king compared to children in third world countries. Many of you that follow us on social media know that we were in Haiti about, I guess, maybe 6 months ago or so, roughly in there. We didn't go over to preach, Pastor. We didn't go over to teach. I didn't go over to do a conference. We went over there to just love kids and just bounce them around on our shoulders and just hug them. And basically, the five things that these children are provided through this ministry is food. It gives them clothing. It gives them an education, get to go to school. It gives them medical care and vaccinations, and obviously the most important thing, the gospel of Jesus Christ. I probably told you these stories before, but they just so beg to be told today because of what we're talking about. There was a story of a young boy, and he was playing with a matchbox car, and he was racing it around on the sidewalk. He had gotten sidewalk chalk and driven it around the race car track. Well, a man who lived next door pulled up in a CLK Mercedes, and it had, you know, leather interior, fire engine red, had 28s on it, and telescopic roof. It had a big bow on the hood. The boy was so blown away, he dropped his little matchbox car, and he walks over to the man. He goes, "Wow!" And the man goes, "You like that, bud?" He said, "You like that? That's a CLK Mercedes. That's a $98,000 sports car." And the boy goes, "Wow, where did you get it?" And the guy goes, "Well, that's the kicker." He said, "My brother just bought me this car for my birthday." And the boy says, "Wow, I wish." And the man goes, "Stop right there. Stop right there, little man. I know what you're going to say. You're going to say you wish you had a brother like that." And the little boy wells up with tears, and he said, "No, I was going to say I wish I could be a brother like that." I wonder if we could be men and women of God like that, that recognize a need, see a need, and respond. You know, to be something like that to someone else. The other story goes that the little boy is looking in an old mom and pop shoe store. Every time I come to Siloam Springs, I like to go down to Main Street because that's the way I remember Siloam. Now you guys are getting all like fancy with cotton patches and things like that. But I remember Main Street. I remember like the Dogwood Festival. I remember like, you know, I remember the Vintage Inn and Occasions. Remember that? I remember all that kind of stuff. And I like going down and seeing a lot of those little mom and pop shops. You know, you see that in Dallas. Everything is big and Gallerias and malls. Well, it was just a little locally owned shoe store. And the boy was staring inside the window and he was blown away by all these shoes. And a man walked by and he just could not figure out why this young boy was so just fixated on this window, these shoes. And then he looked down and he realized the boy had no shoes on his feet. And so compassion fell on the man's heart, and he took the boy inside the shoe store and he said, "Son, which one of these shoes do you like?" And the little boy was so overwhelmed with emotion, he didn't even know what to say. He said, "I don't know, sir, I like those." He said, "But I like those." And then he looked over and he said, "But man, those are beautiful." Well, the man had all three pair of shoes brought to the boy, bought all three pair, fit him up with brand new shoes on his feet, and he had a brand new pair of shoes here, and he had a brand new pair of shoes here, and the boy and the man are walking out of the shoe store, and the boy is just like so blown away with thankfulness and gratitude that he looked up at the man and he said, "Thank you, God." And the man said, "Son, I'm not God." He said, "I'm just one of his children." He said, "Well, I knew you were related somehow." Amen. One Child Matters gives you the opportunity to change a child's life. Food, clothing, education, Jesus, medical care. Gives them everything that they need to turn their life around. When you sponsor a child, we ask you to send a picture of yourself to the child because we want that child to know who is changing their life. We want them to know who is responsible for making a difference in their life. And so there was a couple that sponsored a young boy by the name of Anthony. Anthony lost his dad, and so it was just him and his mom. And so when this couple sponsored Anthony so that he could go to school and have food and help with his family, we said to this couple, "Hey, send your picture so that Anthony can see who is responsible for changing his life." I want to show you this video today because it's going to change your world. We took our cameras from One Child Matters over to where Anthony lived so he could thank personally the people that sponsored him and turned his life around. So I want you guys to check this out. It's called Anthony's Story.
Mi esposa I want to thank you for loving me and sponsoring me. You are a big part of my life. I know you are very far from me, but you are always close to my heart.
What? You didn't have to bring back your problems.
I am happy that God has joined our paths. I no longer feel alone. Thank you for the picture you sent me. I like to look at your photograph and pray for you. I always love my time at One Child Matters Project. They give me tasty food, clothes, and they help me with my education so I can be successful in school. I have many friends there, and there is always time to play. Today I got to do a learning activity that will be sent to you. It was so fun. I love God. I've learned that God loves me and has special purpose for my life. I hold on to that promise. After my walk home, I helped bring the goats into our yard before the sunset. I'm very good at milking them, and it's a big help to my mother because my father passed away. I miss him. As today ends, I have hope for tomorrow because you have changed my world. I pray that God holds you and keeps you safe. Please write to me again soon. I love you. Okay.
Is that not awesome? Amen. And so that's Anthony's story. When Stephanie and I got married, many of you know our story and our testimony, some of you don't. But when Stephanie and I got married, we don't have the opportunity to have children together. It's just not the way that the Lord worked it out. And so she had always wanted children, but we couldn't have any together. And so how many of you know God always has a plan? Amen. So now she has 7 children. And they're in 7 different parts of the world. Did anybody see War Room? Raise your hand if you saw War Room. Man, awesome movie. Amen. Well, we have a war room in our home. And all 7 of our children. I'm not asking you guys to do something that we don't do ourselves. I want to make that clear. We have 7 children that we sponsor every month. All 7 of them are in our war room and they're framed on our wall. And so every day when we go into our war room, we can pray for our kids that are in other countries. This is an opportunity for all of you to do something much, much bigger than yourself. Had a boy come to me in Crystal Springs, Mississippi, and he said, Pastor, I want to sponsor a child. And as excited as I was about that, you know, he was just a little kid. And so I said, are you sure, buddy? He said, oh, yeah, I'm gonna sponsor a child. And I said, well, have you talked to your parents? And he looked at me and said, yeah, because, you know, I don't have a brother anymore. He said, so I'm going to sponsor a child. And so I told my mom and dad, I'm going to rake leaves and cut grass. And I'm going to raise money so that every month I can support a little brother or a little sister in a third world country. Now I want to say this to you, and I mean this in all sincerity. If a 12-year-old can rake leaves and scrape up a few dollars to sponsor a child, there's not a person in this building that can't do that. If I were to say to you right now, your pastor is going to die today, if every person in this room does not come up here and give $39, if everybody didn't come up and give $39, pastor's not going to make it. He won't live past today. None of you would even think about it. You'd all come up and lay down two $20 bills to save pastor's life. That's exactly what you're doing. Unless these kids have somebody that will step up and say, I'll support them, I'll give them food, I'll give them clothing, I'll give them medical care, I'll allow them to go to school, I want them to hear about Jesus, it saves their life. You say, well, Brother Michael, it's expensive, it's $39. Let's be real today. You can't go to Dawn Hill and buy a round of golf for $39. If you were to go to Fayetteville and take your sweetheart to the movies, can I just be real? If you were going to go to the movies and splurge and buy snacks and get popcorn and soda, you can't go to the movies and get popcorn and Cokes for $39. It's not, It's not a pair of Nikes. Most of us will spend $39. If you've got a family of four, you can't go out of lunch today. You can't go to Pizza Hut for $39. $39 changes a child's life for the rest of their life. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. And if you're here today and you say, Pastor, you know what? I would do something that would go far beyond the walls of this church. I'll change a child's life. I want to say one other thing. Someone says, well, if I sponsor a child, I'm locked in, right? I'm locked in. No. You can sponsor a child for as little or as long as you'd like. You can sponsor a child for 3 months. You can sponsor a child for 3 years. You're not locked in on anything. It's just as long as you can do it. But if you're here today and you would help somebody like Anthony, we have in these guys' hands 15, representing 15 of the poorest nations in the world, these children that have no hope. Is there anyone here that you'd say, Pastor, you know what? I'd sponsor a child for a few months. If so, would you lift your hand nice and high? And these guys are going to come and they're going to put a card in your hand. Okay, guys, go ahead and move back. Please keep your hand up until they bring you a card. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you here. Just keep it up nice and high. This is a child in the balance. Keep it up. All right, right here. Right here. Let me say something to everybody that took a card. Everybody look at me for a quick second. I know you want to look at that profile, but look at me really quick. In your hand is a profile. I want to be clear about this when I say this. This is not a pamphlet. This is not some kind of promotional brochure. In your hand is that child. It has their sex. It has their age. It has their birthday. It has what country they're from. This is the child. There is no other card in your hand. In the middle, you'll see there is a page that you can fill out. I'm going to ask you during the service to fill out this page. This is the only time that a minister will ever give you permission to doodle on something while he's preaching. But I'm going to ask you to fill this out. And then tear it out, bring it to Stephanie and I after the service. I have to be clear when I say this. Folks, if you took this, then I must have this after the service. If you take this and I don't have this, you have officially kidnapped my child. Amen. And I don't want that. So if you walk out of here today with this and you don't give me that card in the middle, I will pray that the fleas of 1,000 camels infest your bed and you are miserable for the rest of your life. That's my serious face. No, but anyway, this is little six-year-old Elias. He's from Jordan, and we only got him, maybe a week or two ago. And so if you would like Elias, too, he's out there. I've got him here with me. And if somebody doesn't take him, I have a feeling we'll have 8 children very, very soon that we support. Can we give the Lord praise for all these children that were sponsored? Thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts. So make sure you fill that out afterwards. Will you take the hand of the person next to you right now? We're going to ask the Lord to bless our time together. Father, we thank you for Turning Point. I thank you for the pastors. I thank you for everyone that makes up this great church. And Father, I thank you for what you have done in the past and several years in this family of believers. But Father, I know that there are greater things that you have for TPF here in Gentry. I know that there are greater things that you have for this congregation. So will you touch us and challenge us today? Will you help us to learn something that when we walk out, we're stronger? Father, we have more power, we have more authority, we have more victory. We ask it in Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Give the Lord one more clap off of praise. Thank you so much. Can I get a little bit more mic? Just a little bit. I promise I won't scream. No, I'm going to scream. I know that, but I just not. Anyway. All right. You guys ready for the word of the Lord? Yeah. All right. I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles in a few moments to John chapter 15 and verse 7. And I'm going to share something with you today. I gave you a year or two ago, I think a couple of years ago, one of the parts of this series. And I want to give you the other part. There's actually 3 or 4 parts, but I want to give you another part today. And it's because since we've launched this church, we have really just begun to delve into. We did this series at our church. We're now in another series called The Blessed Life. But there just more and more I'm finding that there is a real vast chasm of misunderstanding in the body of Christ about certain things that should be very, very natural to us. We should know what they are about. We should know how they work. But how many of you know just because you go to church doesn't mean you know everything? And just because you go to church and hear things doesn't mean you've really comprehended everything. And so I want to talk with you today about a prayer. Everybody shout prayer.
Prayer.
So could say with attitude, prayer. Prayer is something that we all know about, and anytime, honestly, in the body of Christ, and a pastor gets up and says, hey, we're going to talk about prayer, usually there's a big long groan because we all think, man, I know how to pray. But I'm telling you this, just because we think we know how to do something doesn't mean that we really fully encompass how it works. I'm just going to prove this to you right now. How many of you have ever prayed, you've asked the Lord for something in prayer, and he did not answer your prayers? Raise your hand nice and high. Come on. Yeah, that's all of us in this room. Have you ever noticed that a lot of prayers go up, but sometimes very seldom do answers come down? And so we have to realize that there's stuff that you got to do in order to get prayers answered. Can I get an amen? God is not some candy machine where you just kind of pop out a prayer and he just drops whatever you need in your lap. There's stuff you got to do. And the last time we were here, we talked about how prayer can change your life, the purposes of prayer. But today I want to talk about the five conditions for answered prayer. Now, I want you guys to think about this for a second. The disciples walked and talked with Jesus. They saw him do all kinds of incredible things. They saw him make the lame walk and the blind see, cast out devils. He walked on water. He spoke to an ocean. I mean, Jesus did a lot of cool miracles. Think about this. When he pulled them aside, never one time did they say, Jesus, teach us how to do those miracles. They saw him preach the most incredible sermons ever. Sermon on the Mount. That no greater preacher ever walked the planet than Jesus Christ. Yet when they got aside with Jesus, they never said one time, Jesus, will you teach us to preach like that? What did they say? Lord, teach us how to... Because they saw that was where his power came from. That was where his anointing and his connection with the Father was. I hear people say all the time, well, you know, God's supposed to answer all my prayers. No, friend. God never promised to answer everyone's prayers. Did you know that there's actually prayers that he ignored in the Word of God? There's ones that he accepted and there's ones that he didn't accept. There's all kinds of prayers. I grew up listening to my mom and dad pray. My mom and dad prayed every morning. Pastor, I didn't even need an alarm clock. I woke up every morning listening to my dad pray, God touch Michael, God touch Michael. That's why my dad prayed. My dad didn't, but my dad prayed. We sit down, you know, for a meal, and he had to pray for every missionary on the face of the planet. And you know, while the turkey was getting cold and the gravy was getting that little skin up on top, you know, you had to bust through the spoon. I'm like, get on with it, Dad. My dad, when we get in a car, he'd lay hands on the airbags, he'd lay hands on the brake pads, and Lord, put a hedge of protection around our car. My dad believed in the power of prayer. How many had praying parents? Amen. And so I'm thankful for parents that taught me how to pray. But just because we know about prayer and we know that we're supposed to do it, it doesn't mean that we're doing it the right way. I just ask all of you, how many of you have ever prayed for God to touch a certain area of your life or move in a certain way or show up in a certain way and it didn't happen? And so evidently we're doing something wrong, because God wants to answer our prayers. God wants to give you the things that you desire. It says that he wants to give us the desires of our hearts. So if we're praying for something and God's not answering, then evidently there is a break in the connections. So there's a dropped call, as we would say nowadays. And so I want to talk with you today about the five conditions for answered prayer. And here's what I'm going to go as far as saying. If you are not doing these five things, you are wasting your breath. But if you do all five of these things that I'm talking about today, guys, you have every right to believe that God will in fact answer your prayers. As a matter of fact, if you do everything that I tell you to do today in these five, matter of fact, if I said I'm going to give you five things, if you did all five, 100% guarantee your prayers would be answered. How many would want to know that information? That's everybody. So here's the deal. If you do all these five, then you have every right. Matter of fact, if you do all these five, then it's on God. At that point, you're going to be able to say, God, I've done everything that I was told to do in your word. And from then on, if it's going to be answered, that's on God. So if you have John verse 7 in chapter 15, I'm going to give you the five conditions for answered prayer. Number one, you have to have an honest relationship with God. Will you say with me? I have an honest relationship with God. John 15 and 7 says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, then ask for for whatever you want, and it will be given to you. Isn't that an awesome scripture? If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then ask for whatever you want, and it will be done for you. Now, I want to tell you what Christians do all the time. We take the part of the verse that we like, and that's the one we quote all the time. God said, I can ask for whatever I want, and it's mine. Well, there's stuff that you got to look at in this verse that you're missing. All right? It says that ask for whatever you want, and it will be given to you. How many of you know that's a beautiful promise? Amen? But in Scripture, every promise has a premise. In Scripture, every promise always has a condition. And so here's the promise. I will give you whatever you ask in prayer. But here is the premise. If you remain in me and my words remain in you. So how do we remain in Christ? The next sentence tells us, by my words remaining in you. In other words, the Bible says that you can ask for whatever you want and it will be given to you. That's awesome. We quote it all the time. But every Christian that I've ever met always forgets about the other part. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, someone say then. Ask for whatever you want, it'll be given to you. So in other words, don't forget the other part. He says, if you remain in me, how do we remain in him? He said, by my words remaining in you. God requires that we listen to him before he listens to us. In other words, you'll hear pastors say, you need to pray, you need to pray. You'll hear a preacher say, you need to pray, get in your prayer closet, everybody needs to pray. But all the time, we think, well, you know, we pray because we have to, or we pray because we're supposed to. I'm going to pray today because if I don't, I'll feel guilty. I want you to be dead honest. God could strike you dead if you lie. Amen. But how many of you have ever felt guilty if you missed praying? Raise your hand nice and high. Look at that. It's everywhere. We all go, well, I better pray, and there it is. It's 1:30. In the morning, and you get down, Lord Jesus. How many have ever fallen asleep praying? Don't lie. Raise your hand. Okay, see, that's everybody. How many of you have ever been reading the Bible and fell asleep? Raise your hand. Right, see, because you're trying to read Leviticus at 3 a.m. You can't do that. Okay, don't read Leviticus at 3 a.m. That's better than Ambien, right? So in other words, it's basic demonology 101. The devil didn't even have to get creative with most of you guys. And so what happens is it becomes like more of a religious duty. I'm supposed to pray. God commanded me to pray. If I don't pray, I'm going to get a bigger curse than the one I've already got on me. And so I need to pray. Prayer is not something that we have. Prayer is something that we get to do. Amen? Prayer is our communication with the Father. I had a pastor have the audacity to say to me one time, well, I love praying, but you know, Michael, it's really not that big a deal. Friends, the spirit of slap came on me. I almost wanted to punch him right in the face. Because how many of you know prayer is the most powerful tool that we have in the body of Christ? Come on, somebody. That's how we communicate with God. And so he said, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, then ask for whatever you want. So here it is. If I don't pay attention to what God says to me in his word, then why should he pay attention when I talk to him? And so we got a lot of Christians, they don't want to think about what the Word of God says. They don't want to do what the Word of God says. But then when they slip up, trip up, mess up, get in a bind, then they want to hit their knees and expect God to answer them. He said, no, 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 no. You haven't been remaining in me. He said, you got to remain in me and have my words in you. Then you can ask for whatever you want and it will be given to you. So we have to have an honest relationship with God. And I know somebody in this building right now is saying, well, you say, Michael, if I don't study my Bible, I won't have answered prayer. No, I'm saying your prayer life will never be more effective than by how much you understand Scripture. The more Scripture you understand, the more powerful your prayer life will become. So how do you make sure that you have an honest relationship with God? Well, here's a good start. Is there anything in your life that you've done wrong in the past that you have not admitted to Jesus? In other words, the Bible calls it unconfessed sin. Okay, let me tell you what confession is. Confession is not going into a little room and sliding over a door and talking to a dude with a collar. Amen? That's not confession. It's not turning on a little light bulb and saying a few poems and kissing a few beads and calling it a day. That's not confession. You know what confession is saying? God, you were right. I was wrong. That's what confession is. Do you know, I know churches that have not really went any further. Pastor, I've seen churches crumble just because someone couldn't admit that they were wrong. I've seen marriages split right down the middle because one spouse couldn't look at another and say, you know what, honey, forgive me, I was wrong. I've seen friendships, I've seen businesses destroyed because of ego and one couldn't look. Why is it so hard for us to just admit when we're wrong? There are times that we just need to say, God, you know what? You were right all along. I confess that anger, that hatred, that bitterness, that lust, that thing in my life that you said shouldn't be there. Lord, put it under the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how you make sure that you have an honest relationship with God. Is there anything in your past? Proverbs 28:13 says, he who tries to conceal his sins cannot prosper, but he who admits them, confesses them, and forsakes them will have mercy. So how do you have an honest relationship with God? Is there anything in your past that is not under the blood of Jesus? Here's another one. Is there anything presently in your life that you are ignoring that is going to make sure that honest relationship with God is hindered? In other words, I know you'd know this from Verizon back in the day, but you know now Sprint has got the Verizon guy. Have you guys seen that? That's the smartest marketing I've ever seen in my entire life, man. That's like Burger King getting Ronald McDonald to start pitching their burgers, right? I mean, this dude was like, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Then Sprint brings his cat on. He's like, I used to say, can you hear me now? But now I got Sprint, blah, 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 blah. Then at the end he goes, can you hear that? That's brilliant from Sprint. Let's steal the Verizon dude. Get him to peddle our phones. But you know what? When you don't have an honest relationship with God, it blocks the signal. How many of you have ever had a dropped call? Raise your hand. Is that not the most annoying thing on the face of the planet? You're like, hey, he said I got AT&T. And I do. Anyway, have you ever been talking to somebody and they're like, hey, you there? And I'm like, I'm right here. And they're like, hey, I'm right here. You can hear them. They can't hear you. You can hear them, but they can't hear you. And you're like, hey, I'm right here. And they're like, hello, hello, I'm right here. I'm right here. They're like, hello, hello, I'm right here. You're just screaming at the top of your lungs, and they can't hear you. The connection's not, it's messed up. Have you ever been in a certain part of town where you know, it's like you go around a certain corner or something, like there's just always a certain place where that's a dead spot. And you'll be talking to someone on the phone, and you'll give them a heads up. You're like, hey, guess what? I'm about to lose you. Because I always lose people when I go down this hill, so I'm about to lose you. If I lose you, I'll call you back. You let them know because you know there's a dead spot there. And that's the way that it is with God. We're talking to God, and God's like, what, what, what? And you're like, God, can you hear me? God, can you hear me? God, can you hear me? But when we don't have that honest relationship with Jesus Christ, you understand the connection is blocked. There's something wrong with the signal. And we got to say, God, is there anything in my life that is blocking you from hearing me? Can I get an amen? Lord, is there anything in my marriage? Is there anything in my parenting? Is there anything on my computer? Is there anything that I'm texting? Is there anything that I'm doing in my life that would be displeasing to you? And if so, then it's going to make that honest relationship destroyed, and then he can't hear you the way that he should. And then you wonder why when you pray prayers, he's not answering your prayers. It's because you got to have an honest relationship with God. Amen. My daughter, I used to tell her all the time to go clean her room when she was young, and she used to love watching the Disney Channel, man. It was just like crack for this little kid, right? It's like she had to have the Disney Channel on all the time. And so I would say, hey, Cameron, you need to go clean your room. Now, here's what you need to understand about God and how he works with his children. If I went back there 15 minutes later to check in her room after she'd been sitting there watching the Disney Channel, I'd say, Cameron, go clean your room. If I went in there and her room was cleaned, okay, maybe she didn't do it like the way I would have done it, you know, because she was a kid, but she did her best, right? She did what I asked her to do. You know, you're not going to bounce a quarter off that bed or anything. It's kind of tucked under, you know, and she shoved everything, but you know, she tidied it. She did her best, right? Then I don't have a problem. But if I go back in there 15 minutes later after I said, Camry, clean your room, and she's still sitting there watching Disney, we're going to have a problem. In other words, what's my point? I don't demand perfection, but I do demand obedience. I don't expect Camry to do it perfectly, but I do ask her to do what I'm asking her to do. And it's the same way with God. He doesn't really demand perfection, but he does want us to obey him and listen to him. So in 1 John, it says we have this assurance that we have approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us whenever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked of him. So number one, you have to have an honest relationship with God. Say it with me. Ready? I have to have an honest relationship with God. Someone shout number two. Here's number two. I have to have a forgiving attitude towards other people. I'm so about to get up. You know what? You didn't even invite me to your barbecue, but I'm still going to get up in your grill. Listen to this. All right. Number one, an honest relationship with God. Number two, you have to have a forgiving attitude towards other people. In other words, how many of you know you can't ask God to answer your prayers if you've got resentment towards other people? You can't ask God to answer your prayers if you've got a beef with your boss or a beef with your kids or a relationship is strained or whatever. The Bible says you got to have a forgiving attitude towards others. Mark chapter 11 verse 24 says this, "Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you received it and it will be yours." That's the promise, okay? Here's the condition. "And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him so that your Father in heaven may forgive your sins." More than any other characteristic in the Bible, TPF, other than faith, I think the number one thing related to prayers being answered is forgiveness. Why? Because nothing will kill your prayers faster than resentment. Amen. Nothing will, when you nurse a grudge or an ill feeling or bitterness, it knocks off your prayers. And in Matthew chapter 5, you don't need to turn there, but Jesus is giving the Sermon on the Mount. And we were there just 3 months ago. We stood right there on the Mount of Beatitudes where he gave the Sermon on the Mount. We were standing right where Jesus stood. And in this sermon, he gives this deal. He says, listen, if you're going to go to church and you're going to bring an offering to me, but you've got a beef against someone, this is what he says. He says, leave the offering there. Leave the offering there, leave, go make it right with that person, and then come back. See, you thought you were going to get off the hook. You thought you'd be able to leave church and take your offering with you. No. Jesus says, if you come to give an offering, he said, but you've got a problem. And then he even goes further. He says, or someone's got a problem with you. Because I know some of you are trying to play that martyr thing. I didn't do it. It's them. It's not me. I've tried everything in my power. They just won't forget. No. He said, if you come to church, you bring an offering, but there is a problem. You've got a problem with somebody or they've got a problem with you. He said, drop the offering right there. You know why I think he said that, Pastor? Because I don't think that offering could be blessed until they do make it right. But in other words, leave the offering there. He said, go find that person, either offer forgiveness, extend forgiveness, or receive their forgiveness. You've got to have, why is that? Because the Bible has that little scripture that says, you can't say that you love God and hate your brother. Hebrews 12:15, watch out that no bitterness take root among you, for as it springs up among you, it causes deep trouble, hurting many in their spiritual lives. You can't have unforgiveness in your heart and have your prayers answered. What do we pray every time we pray the Lord's Prayer? Let me refresh your memory. We say, Father, forgive us our debts as we what? Let me tell you what that's really saying. God, I want you to forgive me just as much as I forgive others. And God, I don't want you to forgive me any more than I'm willing to forgive other people. It's a little bit stronger when you think about it like that, huh? Instead of getting all King James verse, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. No. In other words, when you pray the Lord's Prayer, you're saying, God, don't offer me one shred more of forgiveness than I am willing to give somebody else. Isn't that kind of strong? You can't have your prayers answered if you're not offering forgiveness. 1 Peter also has a few things to say about this. We're going to put it in our own backyard now because let's talk about marriage. I feel like preaching now. Because how many of you know that bitterness and resentment and unforgiveness in the home and in the family is some of the easiest places for some of that stuff to crop up? You know what? Husbands resent wives, and wives resent husbands, and sons get mad at fathers, and fathers and sons and daughters. There's a lot that goes on in the home. And so Peter is giving the lowdown to all the women. And Peter, I'm not going to go into that verse. You women thought you got off the hook, but you didn't, because Peter nailed all you young ladies and said, hey, do this and do this and do this. Make sure that you're honoring your husband, all those things. Then we're going to pick it up in verse 7, and he starts talking to the husbands. He says, husbands, in the same way. In other words, just like he had just talked to the women, he said, husbands, in the same way, he said, honor and be considerate to your wives. Treat them with respect. Listen to this. So that nothing will hinder your prayers. So in other words, Peter was saying, husbands, you need to honor and respect the woman I've placed in your life so that nothing will hinder your prayers. It's saying right there, Peter's saying, you know what? You can't be mad at your spouse and have prayers answered. He said, you need to make sure that none of your prayers are hindered. Did you know that the Bible says that disharmony in the home blocks answers to prayers? You can't be at home and be like, shut up, I'll kill all y'all. Father, in Jesus' name. Let your presence rest upon our home. You can't do that. Huh? Come on. Some of you were driving to church. I'll kill y'all. I'll kill every last one of y'all. Shut up. How you doing? God bless you. Good morning. How are you? We have all this tension. We have all this resentment. We have all this going on in the home. And then we want to sit down for a family devotion. Or we want to pray over a meal. It doesn't work that way. Peter said, through the unction of the Holy Spirit, wives, honor your husbands. Husbands, respect your wives. Why? So that nothing will hinder your prayers. That's pretty strong. Matter of fact, if you go back in the Old Testament, it lists qualifications that a pastor had to have in his life in order to be a pastor or a deacon. One of the qualifications for being a deacon in the Old Testament church was to have a happy, peaceful home life. Why? Because they knew, even back in the Old Testament, if there were tension in the home, their prayers of their leadership would be completely ineffective. You got to make sure that you're talking with the Lord and say, God, you know what? That argument that I had with my spouse, or that ill feeling that I had towards my boss, Lord, that goofball that cut me off today on Highway 412 and I cursed him, Lord, that got to. I'm serious. I'm so serious. You have to make sure that... I'll tell you seriously. This is a true story. I'm not making this up. This has become a rather famous story with my wife and I. But one day, my wife and I were having what I like to call an intense moment of fellowship. We were having a fight. But we'll just call it an intense moment of fellowship. Now, I'm old school in my house. I turn off lights all the time. Do any of you men do that? Raise your hand if you do that. Like, I'm old school. I don't think that lights should be on in certain parts of the house if you're not in there. Go figure. It's just, I know, and people are like, no, just go to Lowe's and get those little curly Q ones. It's 42 million hours for a nickel. I get it. It doesn't matter. I'm just old school. I turn off lights. It's not even like, oh, the electric bill. You know, remember when your dad used to say, the electric bill, it doesn't grow on trees. No, it's not that. It's just like, if we're all in one part of the house and all 14 other rooms have lights on, that's dumb in my opinion. So one day I was going through the house and I was turning off lights, and Steph was in another part of the house. She was in there watching TV. So I was turning off lights because I'm thinking, you know, we're all in here and there's no reason for all that to be on in there. So I'm going and clicking off lights. I walked into her office. I want to be very clear when I say this. Notice I said I walked into her office because the light was on. I walked in her office because the light was on. How many of you know I wouldn't have walked in the office if the light wasn't on? That's why I walked in the office. So I walked in there to turn off her lamp that she has on our office desk. Now, her office desk lamp is a piece of coral. You know, it's like just some coral that they took out of the ocean and they popped a lampshade on it. So it's this big, jagged piece of coral with a lampshade. I went in there to turn the lamp off. And, Pastor, I guess I got a little careless. I went in to, real fast, to turn the lamp off, and that coral jabbed me. Ow! Like right in the finger. I'm bleeding. I'm like, turn your lamp off. That's what I did. I said, turn your lamp off. Just like that. She didn't hear me. I was hot. Man, I'm telling you, I'm bleeding.
I walk in the other side of the house. She's all like, what's the problem? She's like, what's wrong with you? I said, I'll tell you what's wrong with me. I said, I walked into your office and the lamp was on because you didn't turn it off. And so and she goes, no, the lamp wasn't on. I went, I said, no, the lamp was on. She goes, the lamp was off. I said, the lamp was on. She said, the lamp was off. She got all like attitude with me saying the lamp was off. I said, no, it's not. She goes, how do you know? I said, I'll tell you how I know the lamp was on. You see that blood coming out of my finger right now? It's bleeding because I tried to turn your lamp off and it poked me. And that's that hole in my finger. She looks at me and she goes, you're crazy. That lamp was off. I was like, oh my gosh. I can't believe you're so egotistical and full of yourself. Oh, Miss Stephanie can never be wrong. And we were fighting back and forth. It's like, it's a lamp, people. It's just a lamp. It's not a big deal. And we're in this like WWE SmackDown over a lamp. So I called my dad. I was like, oh my goodness, this woman I married. Give me a break. Dad, I went in there. I jabbed my finger. I'm bleeding down my hand. And she had the nerve to tell me that the lamp was off when it was clearly on. And my dad said the most profound words. I've never forgotten them. Some of you men should take this to heart. My dad said, well, you can be right or you can be happy. That'll preach all day. Y'all need to remember that on your next little moment of fellowship that's intense. And I thought to myself, that's so true. Now, are you ready for this? Most people would rather be right. And that's why marriages are so jacked up, because they would rather say, I won that argument, rather than just saying, who cares, and have a happy atmosphere in their home. They would rather literally it be stale and stiff and weird and thick and tension and no, I won that argument, rather than it just being a pleasant atmosphere at home and in the marriage, but just not have to prove their point. Can I get an amen? So that night we went to bed. And we pray every night before we go to bed. That's just what we do. It's our thing. I'm not saying it has to be your thing. It's just our thing. We decide we're not going to go to bed without praying. Now, I'm not saying every single time we like tear our clothes and rub ashes on our head and take communion. It's not like a big deal. But, you know, we just usually just pray a prayer. Sometimes, Lord, bless our day. Touch us. Give us good rest of that. Amen. Well, she was still fuming over the whole lamp deal. So I come to bed and I'm laying there and I get into bed and she is already facing the other way. I mean, covers over, pillow blocking me, just there, like this. I know she's awake. And so I got into bed, and I was like, well, are we not going to pray tonight? Are we not going to pray tonight like we always do? Are we not going to pray before we go to bed tonight? Why is tonight different than any other night? And so her hand just goes, like, she doesn't roll over, she doesn't look at me, nothing. She just goes, pray. And because I'm brilliant in street smarts, Steph has book smarts, I have street smarts. I said, well, you know what, babe? I feel like the Holy Spirit is saying that you should pray this evening. And man, she rolls over, the big old white girl's overbite. She's ticked, and she goes, she takes my hand, because I know. Because I know, you can't, hear me, you can't from your heart pray in sincerity and be all ticked off. You just can't do it. It's impossible. You just can't do it. Now, you say, why? You tell me I need to pray for my husband? Absolutely. Now, don't be like, Lord, pray for my stupid husband right now. Pray for him right now, my stupid husband. But we just started to pray. She started to pray. I started to pray. And I'm telling you, like melting butter, I mean, the whole atmosphere in that room changed. Everything changed. She held me. I held her. We were weeping and praying. It was just a beautiful thing. Why? Because I want my prayers answered. Amen? Do you want God to listen to you? And so God says, if you want me to listen to you, then number one, have an honest relationship with me. Number two, make sure that there's no bitterness, there's no anger, there's no resentment, there's no unforgiveness. Can I get an amen? So after it was all over, we rolled over and we started to go to sleep. And can I tell you, it was so beautiful. She got out of her bed. She walked all the way around. We have this massive bed. She walked all the way around and crawled inside of bed with me. You say, why did she just roll over? Because we have a 180-pound Great Dane in between us, and I don't even want to talk about that. That's just not. Do I look like I'm laughing? I don't even want to talk about it. Someone say number three. You have to be willing to share the results. Number one, you have to not have an honest relationship with God. Number two, no unforgiveness towards others. Number three, you got to be willing to share the report, the results. In other words, what you sow, you give, and it will be. Okay, so the principle of generosity, the more you give out, the more God gives to you. How do you expect God to bless your life if you're not willing to bless other people's lives? How do you expect, oh, God, touch my job, but what are you going to do with that job or that extra income when you, Lord, I need that debt canceled. Lord, would you give me a raise? Lord, will you do this? Will you do, Lord, will you heal my body? But what are you going to do with that healthy body when he heals you? In other words, you got to be willing to share the results. You got to be generous. You got to be willing to bless others. I could tell you time and time and time again in my life and in Stephanie's life where, Pastor, we look for ways to be generous. We look for people to bless. Happens all the time. Some of you have heard the story. Some of you have seen the videos on Facebook. But, man, I was in a store one time in an airport, and the two kids wanted something to eat, and the mom was getting them something, and she was struggling and getting her cards out, and I just bought my stuff, and I just started to walk away, and the lady said, ma'am, I'm sorry, it declined. And you know, I just stopped for a second, and the lady, you could tell there was people behind her, and they're huffing and puffing because they're in an airport and they're trying to get to their gates, and the kids are crying. They're like, mom, I really wanted these chips to eat, and I'm hungry. And mom just, kids, it's fine. And you could tell she tried another card, and the lady just looked at her and said, ma'am, that declined too. And just the Holy Spirit said, take care of that. It was nothing. It was literally nothing. It was like $15. But I'm saying, you know, so they left, and the woman was embarrassed, and I said, ma'am, let me get that stuff real quick, and I ran over and gave it to her, you know, made her day. What is the point? My point is, because sometime down the road, I'm going to have a need. Sometime down the line, I'm going to have a need. It might be a whole lot more than $15. And I want God to look down and say, Michael, you know what? I'm listening to you right now. I didn't turn a deaf ear to you because there was that time in that airport and you helped somebody in their need. Come on, somebody. Why do you think this morning before we started, I started this one child and I gave all of you an opportunity to sponsor a child? Why? Because in Proverbs 21:13 it says, if a man shuts his ears to the cry of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. Man, that's strong. Somebody better catch that. If you heard anything I said today, if you walk out of here with anything that I've said today, you ought to remember Proverbs. If a man shuts his ears to the cry of the poor, he too will cry out and not be answered. Why do we look for people to be generous with? Why do we look for people to bless? Because we want to be blessed. Did anybody see when we bought the couple's groceries about a week ago? Did anybody see that on Facebook? It was just so fun, and it lifted our spirits, and Steph's all giddy. She gets on, look what we did today, everybody. I'm so happy. Why? Because it just helps your heart. Amen? It blesses your heart to help somebody. We were in a grocery store, and this older couple, and they didn't look impoverished or destitute. We just were checking out, and I was looking over, and I looked at them, and they're so cute, Pastor. They're so cute. And I wanted to make sure I wasn't doing it because they were cute, you know? And we go, oh, look at the cute old people. Jeez, you know, this is probably their last day on earth. No, it's not that. I was terrible. But anyway, you know, I shouldn't have said that. It was funny, though. But I wanted to make sure it wasn't like just me, you know, because they were cute. And so I'm looking, and Steph's getting ready to check out, and I'm looking over her, and I'm looking at their stuff, and I'm looking back, and I'm looking at their stuff, and Steph looks over at me, and she's, what is it? I didn't even say anything. I was like, I looked there, and she went, oh, me too. It's just so cool. Like, she was thinking it, I was thinking, she goes, oh, me too. And so I looked over, and I said, hey, how you guys doing today? And he put this little mug up with a little dog sticking out of it. And I was like, oh, who's that for? He goes, it's for my wife. Today's her birthday. I tried to sneak it in. So we didn't even know. It was so cute. And I said, well, you know what? For your birthday, we just want to take care of y'all's groceries. And like this guy, no, please don't do it. I mean, I could tell you over and over and over how many times. One more. This is too cool. We have a place in Dallas called Pi Five. You guys have Pi Five? Nah, I'm sorry. Anyway, High Five's going to be in heaven. Jesus will be there eating with us because it's like Chipotle, but it's pizza. So you go through and build your own pizza. And so we were in there, and this little African-American lady, she was just in there working, and all of a sudden we're going through, and that lady, she's like, something smells good. Something smells good. And I looked at her and said, thank you. And she goes, I'm not talking to you. She said, I'm talking to your beautiful wife. And Stephanie said, oh, thank you. She said, baby, what is that? And she said, I think it's Gucci or something. She goes, oh, Gucci's. She said, oh, Gucci's. I can't afford no Gucci's. Said, I can't afford no Gucci's. And so we got our pizza, and we sat down. We prayed over the meal. And I was about to take a bite of pizza. And I went, you know, and Steph looks at me. She goes, I already know what you're going to say. I already know what you're going to say. So we went over to the department store and we bought this Gucci perfume, same stuff she had on. But it was Christmas. You got to go to our Facebook page. The video's on our Facebook page and see this. Yeah, just go to Michael Rowan Ministries today and click on videos. It's right there. Just bless your day. So anyway, we walk in, and so I videoed it. And so Steph's like, hey, everybody, it's Christmas. And this lady complimented me on a perfume, and we just wanted to bless her. So I follow her in. We walk all the way in, and the lady, as we get close, and Steph has his bag and the tissues off, the lady goes, no, you didn't. No, no. And we're like, Merry Christmas. I'm like, open it up. She starts pulling tissue out. She goes, I smell it. I smell it, baby. I smell it. And she opens it. She's like, Gucci, 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 Gucci. She's running around like she won Publishers Clearing House. It was a bottle of perfume. Do you hear me today? It was not that big of a deal, but I know that one day I'm going to have needs in my life. I'm going to need God, and I'm going to want to drop down on my knees and say, God, I'm in a bind right now. I need you to hear me. And he's going to say, hey, remember those children you sponsored? Remember that lady at the grocery store? Remember the lady with the perfume? Remember the lady? Why? Because that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to have an honest relationship with him. He wants us to make sure that there's no bitterness, no resentment, no unforgiveness in any of our lives with any others. He wants us, when he does answer our prayers, to turn around and be a blessing to other people. Amen? Number four, he wants us to pray in faith. You got to expect God will answer. Matthew 9:29. According to your faith, it will be done to you. Amen? You can't even please God if you don't have faith. Do you understand that? I'm not even talking about getting prayers answered. I'm talking about you can't even have God pleased with you if you don't have faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. You say, what is faith? I asked someone one time, I said, what's faith? They said, you know what? I'll tell you what faith is. Pastor, my faith has risen up, and God, I believe God can do it. My faith is high. God can do it. That's not faith. That's fact. How many of you know God can do it whether you have faith or not? God can do it whether you pray or believe it or not. When we say God can do it, that's not faith, that's fact. God can do it regardless of how you feel. You say, well, God might. I believe God might do it. God might just turn that situation around. That's not faith either. That's hope. If it's saying God might do it, how many of you know faith is not God can, God might. How many know faith is God will do it? Come on, God, you will touch my marriage. You will turn my finances around. You will heal my body. You will make this church do great things in church. God, you will. Honestly, if God answered some of y'all's prayers, you'd have a heart attack and die. God has not answered some of y'all's prayers to keep you alive. I'm serious. I'll prove it right now. How many of you have ever prayed, God answered your prayer? Be honest, and you were actually surprised. Be honest. Raise your hand. Yeah. Like you're like, I prayed. God answered my prayer. Hallelujah. Well, that's the way that it works, people. Why do we get so shocked and blown away? Because I think sometimes we don't really believe. We don't really believe God will turn that situation around. We don't really believe that prodigal will come back home. We don't really believe that that marriage is too far gone. We don't believe that the doctor's report's going to be reversed. We don't believe. But God says, according to your faith, let your faith rise up and say, God, you will come through in this situation. Will you help me as I begin to close? So, number one, you have to have an honest relationship with God. Make sure that there's nothing blocking your communication with God. No drop calls, no dead spots. So take an inventory of your life. Is there anything in my past? Is there anything in my present right now? Is there anything that I am ignoring that would block me having that honest relationship with Jesus Christ? Number two, I got to make sure that I have no unforgiveness towards anyone. No resentment, no bitterness. But Brother Michael, you don't know what they did to me. It doesn't matter. I am not going to hold on to something that someone did to me and in return make sure that God is turning a deaf ear to all of my prayers. It's too important to me to know that God hears me. He hears me when I call upon Him. So if that just means letting some junk go, friends, let it go. Number three, I got to share the results. If God answers my prayers, I got to bless other people. And I want to tell you, by the way, it's not always monetarily. Sometimes it's just an act of kindness. Sometimes it's just turning around. We were going through the airport in a TSA, and an elderly man, you could tell he had not bathed. You could tell he had been dealt a pretty rough hand in life. He was struggling physically, and these idiots at TSA were making this guy who could barely stand up get out of his chair and disrobe and do all this stuff. And he's trembling, and he's trying to struggle, and he couldn't even reach to take his shoes off. And Stephanie went over and got down on her knees. And I want to tell you guys, this is a big deal, because how many of you know feet are not attractive? Can I get a witness? Some of you are married and in love. You're like, I love you, baby, but I'm not touching your feet. You get to know that right now. And so as she peeled off his feet, you could see just dirt and grime. And, you know, I knew for Stephanie that would have taken a lot, you know, and just helped him and got him and took off his shoes and stuff, just serving, just doing something, because I'm going to have legitimate needs in my life. I'm going to have times where I have to call out upon God, and I want Him to be able to look in the inventory of my life and say, I see time and time and time and time again where You were so generous. Fourth, I've got to let my faith rise up. I got to believe not that He can, not that He might, hoping that He could possibly. I want to say, God, You will. You will demonstrate Your power in my life. And fifth and finally this morning, you got to pray in Jesus' name. You got to pray in Jesus' name. This is my favorite one, and it's one that we miss often. John 14 says, and I will do whatever you ask, say it with me, in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. John 16:24 says, you've not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be complete. What is the big deal about Jesus' name? I mean this. I'm legitimate on this. I was like, what's the big deal? He says, I got to ask in His name. He says, I haven't asked for anything in His name. Ask in His name and I will receive. What is the big deal? You do understand the day in Jesus' day, that was not a significant name. There were many young lads all over Jerusalem named Jesus. It was not, demons did not tremble before Jesus' time. We all know now that every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess. We know that at the mention of His name, demons have to flee. But I'm talking about back then, it was a very common name. So why did Jesus specifically put in His word, you've not asked for a single solitary thing in your prayer life in my name. Ask that your joy may be complete. Because honestly, Pastor, I used to just think that's the way we ended prayers. You know, it was kind of like the sign off. Lord, blah, 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 blah. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. I thought it was kind of a righteous okie dokie. You know, it's just a sign off. If you're ever on the phone with somebody, here's something for you blabbermouths. If you're on the phone with somebody and they go, okie dokie, they want you to shut up. Do you get it?
Hey, how's it going? Well, this happened, and the cable guy came, and then I forgot the milk at the grocery. And they're like, all right, okay, okie dokie. All right, God bless. They want to get off. Am I right?
If someone after church today, and you're talking to them, and they're walking backwards towards their car, they're like, all right, man, okay. But shut up. Matter of fact, if they're walking backwards and they throw the okie-dokie in there to boot, you just need to shut your trap. If they're like, all right, okay, man, okie-dokie, all right. So I used to think okie-dokie is the password to God. Lord, we ask all these things, code word, in Jesus' name. So what's so special about his name?
I close with this. There was a young boy, and he was having his 10th birthday, and the dad came to him, and he said, son, what do you want for your birthday? Do you want X-Men? Do you want Spider-Man? Do you want Batman? Do you want Star Wars? Do you want a birthday party? Do you want cake? And the kid says, no, dad, I want to take all my friends to the carnival and ride rides. Because what had happened is a carnival, kind of like at Grape Fest, you know? You know those, they're not really rides, they're like vomit traps, is what they are. This is a vomit trap on wheels. And they just unfold it, and it spins around, makes people vomit, and then they fold it up, and it goes down the road to the next place. But anyway, that's what had happened. It was kind of like a Grape Fest. They went to a Walmart parking lot, and they'd unfolded all these rides. It was a little carnival there for a week. And so the boy said to his dad, Dad, I don't want a birthday cake. I don't want anything. I don't want Spider-Man. I don't want X-Men. I don't want Star Wars. I want to take all my best friends to ride rides at the carnival. And the dad said, okay. So the day came, and he told his son, you can have you and 11 of your buddies, a dozen, just you, 11 of your best friends, will go to the carnival. So he went to the carnival that day with his 11 friends and his son, so his dad and the 12 people, and he bought a big roll of tickets. And they went to ride a ride, and the dad would stand in the front, and he would tear off tickets, and he would give them to the son and his 11 friends, 12 tickets. And that happened about two or three times. Then about on the fourth ride, he handed out 13 tickets. And he couldn't figure out what was going on. And so he went to the next ride, he handed out 13 tickets again. Well, after about the seventh ride, he figured out there was just this random kid that had joined the birthday party that had nothing to do with the party. And so on about the 10th ride, he stood in the front. He handed his son his ticket, and he went on through, and he handed 11 tickets out, 12, and here comes his 13th kid. And the dad looks at the kid and says, are you a part of this birthday party? The kid goes, no. He goes, well, do you know my son? He said, no. He said, well, dude, why should I give you a ticket? And the boy looked up, welling up with tears, and said, well, your son said you would. So he gave him one. I have no right to think that the God of the universe would care about my prayers. I have no right to think that amidst all the things that's going on in the world, God would care about my little petty problems. But you know what? I can come to the Father because Jesus said so. Come on, somebody. I can come to Jesus, and I can say, God, I come to you right now, and I know I'm not worthy, but I'm coming on behalf of Jesus Christ. He said so. You see, God's up there saying, why should I give you these things? Why should I answer your prayers? Why should I bless you? And we can come on the merit of Jesus Christ. Amen? We can come because Jesus is the link to the Father. He's the connection we have to the Father. Do I have to pray, Brother Michael, in Jesus' name at the end of every prayer? I mean, why not? Why not? It gives us the right, you know what it does? It gives us a reminder of why we have the privilege to come to Him in the first place. Amen? It reminds us of why. You know what? If you want to get all spicy, start out with it. Amen? Just say, Lord, I come to you right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I come before, don't even, at the end, put it in the middle. Man, pray for a little while and then say, in Jesus' name. Then end it in Jesus' name. If that gets a little monotonous, say, God, I come before you today in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. That's why I come before you.
Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise in this building, all around this building. But the problem is, you guys don't think he's concerned. You don't think he's concerned with cell phone bills or bank payments or a mortgage or a rent. You don't think he's concerned with utilities. I mean, he's God. He's got all these incredible, amazing, wonderful things going on. But see, he cares. He cares about every single thing that you have weighing heavy upon your heart. You say, but does he really care about my business? Does he really care? I need a few more clients. Man, my kid is acting like crazy. And man, it's just a little stale between my spouse and I. Or, you know, this person hurt me. Or, Lord, he cares. And so he says, do these five things. Make sure your relationship with me is honest. Think about it right now, every one of you. Is there anything, past or present, that would be displeasing to God? Because if there is, you're wasting your breath. So clear that up. Lord, there's nothing I put under the blood. Everything in my past or in my present, anything that would grieve your Holy Spirit, anything, Father, that would displease you, I erase it in Jesus' name. And then that open connection is there. And then you say, you know what? I'm going to make sure I have no ill will, no ill feelings towards anybody. And then when God does answer my prayers, and when he does bless me, and when he does get me out of debt, and when he does give me a raise, and when I do get that unexpected blessing, I'm not going to keep it for myself. I'm going to bless other people. God will be able to say, I can trust blessing them because I see that they're giving it out to other people. They're being generous. Then, Lord, I'm going to let my faith rise up. I'm going to let my faith rise up to believe you will do what you said you would do. And Father, I pray it not on my own merit. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, if you believe that, give the Lord praise one more time. Hallelujah. 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 Did that help somebody today? Amen. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, for every man, woman, boy, and girl in this building. Father, for the homes and the marriages and the families and the businesses. Father, for those that are here today and they've been struggling. Father, for those that have been wondering, why has the heavens been deaf to me? Lord, maybe today they're starting to realize that there's some adjustments that they've needed to make in their life. And they can have their prayers answered. Lord, you want to do that. You said in your word, ask for whatever we want. As long as we're remaining in you and you want to give it to us. And so, Father, if there's anyone here today that has been confused why we haven't heard from you the way that we think we should, then, Father, let us take out a magnifying glass and look at the inventory of our lives and say, what one of these five things have been lacking in Jesus' name? And everyone said, see, Pastor, when someone comes up to me and says, Pastor, you know what? I've been praying for this for about 4 months, but nothing has moved. I have been praying for this thing, and it just seems like God has not. I'm not some big spiritual guru, but in the back of my mind, when they're telling me, I've prayed about this, I've prayed it over and over and over, and I just can't seem to get a breakthrough. Immediately, I just say, in the back of my mind, well, one of those five things is being missed. Because God says, if you do all five, I will answer your prayers. Amen. Can I bless you this morning? Put your hands out like this. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. May he cover you with his name, the name of Jesus. Father, for every outstretched hand, bless their families, bless their marriages, bless their physical health, bless their finances, bless their relationships, their homes. Father, bless this church. For every outstretched hand, bless them with favor unlike they've ever known. We believe it, we receive it, we allow our faith to rise up and say it with me, and we pray it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, come on, one more time for Jesus! Hallelujah! Now, the Cowboys, there's no prayer there that can be. No, I'm just kidding. I want to say for those of you that...
For those of you that took a child, before we're done today, before the youth that took a child, please, I implore you, make sure that I have that middle page. We're out at the table. If in the course of this last few minutes, maybe some of you are like, in this message, you know what, Brother Michael, I haven't been generous. I haven't been generous, and I need God's touch upon my life. Maybe in the last 45 minutes, God has touched you, and you would like to sponsor a child. They're out there. And then last but not least, as always, Steph has her little bling for the king. She used to call it witness wear. Now she calls it bling for the king. She's got some beautiful jewelry that she did not have last time. When we were here first time, we gave you our original. I'm not sure if we gave our five brand new DVDs the last time we were here. I can't remember. And then also, we have a brand new worship CD. So I'm not going to tell you the whole spiel. There are 12 of our top most requested messages out there on DVD, but the five conditions for answered prayer, today's message, also the other three parts of the series are out there. How to pray about your problems and prayer can change your life. It's a three-part series. I just gave you one part today. We got one out there that's brand new. It was recorded live at Pastor Rod Parsley's church, World Harvest Church. We had 5,000 people show up this night. We caught it all on video. It was an awesome night. We got one out there that's new on loneliness. We got the Titanic, the Human Side of Ministry, but most excited about, and I recorded some of it here, but it's called Redeemed. You all have probably our studio worship CD. This is our brand new live. Came out about 6 months ago, our live worship CD. This is what we've done in the past. Some of you have even done this. Please do not get mad at me when I say this, but we switched up everything because we wanted to really just get the gospel in everybody's hands. There are 13 discs out there for 20 apiece. That's $260. So what we used to do is sell the whole entire collection for, I think, $175 or something like that. Now we sell the entire collection for $125. And so literally you get almost 8 DVDs for free. So you could have all 13 DVDs, the prayer series, Titanic, all that stuff, the new worship CD, all of it for $125 instead of $260. So that's quite a savings. In a moment, Pastor is going to come. He's going to give you an opportunity to bless the ministry. Our third installment here is today. This is our third time that we've been with you guys. I will tell you the same thing I tell you every time. We have never once, you guys know this, Brant knows this, our 50 Club here, that we love you guys so much to support us. You all know this. We are a faith-based ministry. That's why we have a 50 Club. We do not have contracts. We do not have minimums. I've never once, even before I knew the size of the church, the first time I ever talked to Pastor, I never said how many people are here and I need this much money and I want air. We could have very easily flown here. Well, we wanted to save coming into Heifel. That's about $375 on American. So you're talking about close to an $800 bill. And so we wanted to save the church $800, and so we just drove here. And so we drove the 5 hours instead of flying. We're not even going to do a hotel tonight or a meal. We're going to, after the service, go straight home, 5 hours back, get home 2 o'clock in the morning. But we do that to save the church because a lot of churches have to spend somewhere in around $1,200 to $1,700 before I ever say a word. That's without giving us a penny. And so we try to make this as palatable and easy for the church, for the size that you are, that we can. The only thing that I asked Pastor, I said, Pastor, give them, out of the generosity of their hearts, a chance to bless the ministry. He said, well, there's only 100 people here. I think this is proof pudding that when you put your heart into something, look, you guys, that deserves a hand. Over $5,000 towards you guys' future. And I thought that was awesome. So I'm asking you to put that same kind of heart in blessing the ministry today. We are in Indiana next week. I'm sorry, Kentucky. Then we go to Indiana. Long story short, as always, we will zigzag the country and we will not take a Sunday off until November or December when we go back to Israel. You should go to Israel with us too. I'll just throw that in there. We're taking 36 people to the Holy Land, November 20th through the 30th. But anyway, thank you guys for being here. I hope you'll come over to be with us tonight at 5 o'clock. Welcome back, the one, the only, Pastor Dwayne Driggers.
If you enjoyed his ministry, give him a hand. Would you come on today? Let them know it. A great day. Ushers, are you ready? We're prepared to give this morning. Again, you can give online, tpfgentry.com. You can go to the giving tab there and give on there as well. And they're gonna pass the Bucket there by you. And Christy's got a song on her heart. She's going to sing for us. Something. And I got good news. I got a text. I don't know if you got the text yet, but her mom and is not. There's no chest. The chest pains were not any heart condition. They think it's a gallbladder. So maybe this will be a simple thing they'll get taken care of. Give the Lord a hand for that. Amen. I know it was a tough morning for them to be here, and I know that's Cameron's sister too. So, but there was some good news to come through as we were sitting in the service. It's always good to get a good report. Amen. And as again, he said last week, some of you didn't get to be here last week. Last week we started TPF Future. And last Sunday, our evangelist that was here last Sunday, she felt led to talk about it. She got up, and that morning we had zero when we walked up here, but $5,490 when we left. And it's still there, and it's growing, and we're going to keep on raising it up because we have a future ahead of us. And so we're going to give you opportunities throughout every month. And any time you can go online and give, you can give any time through offerings. You can. This is not going to be something I set up here and talk about every service, but it's something we're going to keep in front of you. Let your faith, let your future continue to grow in front of you. Because I believe if it's in front of you, you're going to remind yourself, hey, this is our future. Amen. And God's got great things for us. And as you see, we're outgrowing this building. We got a lot of families out this morning, and we're still a full house here this morning. If we had everyone here right now, we would probably have to have chairs up here and back there. And that's a good problem. I like that problem. Amen. But today we just want to say God bless you. Thank you for your giving today. Thank you for being faithful. Go by the table. Let them know how they blessed you this morning. Bless them. Buy some of the bling. Buy some CDs, DVDs, whatever they got out there. But most of all, go by, shake their hands and let them know they blessed you today. God bless you and have a great day in the Lord. Amen. God bless you today.